Hi, good morning, and welcome to Microsoft Virtual Academy. Today, we're going to be talking about how to leverage your the power of the cloud with your on-prem SQL instances. My name is George, and I'm a program manager from Microsoft. I work on the SQL Server team, and I've worked extensively with the in-memory OLTP feature in SQL Server 2014. And today, we have Xin with us.
Okay. So, thanks, George. My name is Xin, and I'm also a program manager on the SQL Server team at Microsoft. And my focus has been also on the hybrid features in the cloud.
Okay, so today for this 45 minutes, I suppose, we are going to be talking about backup to cloud, backup to URL in SQL 2012 and 2014. We're going to be talking about the backup to Windows Azure tool that we have, and we're going to talk about the new feature, manage backup to Windows Azure. And we are, so today we're targeting DBAs, IT professionals, and developers, DevOps, you know, people who are all, and also people who are already using Windows Azure virtual machines. And we invite you to join the MVA community, and you can get some cool stuff. So first, I'm aware that we already have the backup to URL feature in SQL 2012. So, Xin, can you give us like an overview of what we have in
SQL
2012 and 14?
Let's get started.
All right.
So, backup to URL feature is first introduced in SQL 2012, CU2. So, we first introduced the T-SQL statement, where we actually now starting support to be on the device type now can actually support URL in addition to the ones that you are familiar with, like the disk and also tape. So first of all, as you can see, the URL type is included in here. In addition to that, we have also introduced the support on PowerShell as well as SMO, like in here. So a lot of the people were asking, why this is useful. So mainly we see the benefits as we can leverage the Windows Azure storage now to be your bottomless feature, so your bottomless storage, so you'll be able to actually do your backup to cloud without have to be concerned about how much storage you have and how to actually manage your devices. And also you get the geo redundancy by default because this is already supported and also provided by the Windows Azure Storage.
All right, sweet. So this is really, really cool because right now I can have, you know, unlimited kind of storage. But I'm just wondering, what kind of, you know, performance benefits or, you know, even hits that I can expect when I use Windows Azure? You know, what kind of factors will, you know, kind of slow down or speed up my backup?
Mm-hmm. That's a fair question. So before we go there, and first of all, I want to introduce also, you know, what would be the usefulness of it. Like, you know, when we're thinking about backup to cloud, we want to compare against, first of all, like, you know, backup to the local box and also even backup to Windows Azure Virtual Machines. They all have limits, and size is one concern.
Right.
The size now, we can actually lift that band by using the backup to cloud. On the flip side, there are also caveats or, you know, limitations to this feature, of course. As you mentioned, the performance is one part. Like what I'm showing up in here is the particular test that we have done, depending on the network characteristics of your network.
Right.
This is mainly what you're going to see, depending on the size of the backups that you're doing, and also on the other side, the restore, that, you know, the size is also based on your network latency as well as the bandwidth. So for Windows Azure Virtual Machines, we typically have fairly, you know, large bandwidth. That's not a big concern. But if your own network has a lot of, you know, it's a low or long latency network, then that could be a bottleneck. So this is going to be proportional to that. On the other hand, you also may have concerns or over, you know, like security or even compliance reasons where you may have, you do not want to consider to even put your backups offside, which is totally understandable. And also that could be a limitation to you. And of course, if your backup file exceed 1 terabyte in a single file, then this would not be for you because that is a current limitation for Windows Azure Storage, you know, blob size as well. So that is mainly this feature. And we want to do a quick demo just so that people understand what this looks like. So what I'm going to show in here, as I mentioned, we have SMO, we have PowerShell, we have also the T-SQL statement support. And in SQL 2014, we actually did something you're very familiar with, like, you know, the backup restore UI that you already know. This is something that you can actually easily get started using this feature. For example, I have a database in here called TestDB, and I can just pull up my tasks where I have my backup task, and I can just quickly pull up this UI and show you how it's done. So you can see in here, now I have a backup to device type called URL. And for example, if we want to do backup, we could do full or differential or T-log, and let's do a T-log in here. And I can even provide the SQL credential. This is the part where you would need to actually kind of, you know, this is considered as a wrapper for your storage account and also the key. For instance, I have in here, this is the one I have created. And then if you don't have a storage account or a credential, you can actually create on the spot. And this is the new UI that allows you to do that. So since we already have one, we can just quickly go over and do this. But I want to actually also highlight that we have now also encryption supported within this feature as well, actually across the board. So this is nice to have as well. So for instance, I can specify a certificate and then I can go back to my general and then I can do a quick T-log backup. Oops, looks like, you know, I have just given the wrong credential for some. Oh, this is because I'm actually given this is the wrong container. So that's deselect this one and then go back to that and see if we have a duplicate of some sort. And let's see. Okay, now my test DB has just has been done successfully. Going back, we can also do restore, and I will not complete the restore steps, but just want to quickly show you what it's going to be like. Similarly, we'll be actually going through the storage account and provide the key, and that's connect through that. And then we can see that related to my test DB, we already have this created, and then we can just go from there. So that's basically it.
All right.
So this feature, as I mentioned, it's only for SQL 2012 and above. But what would be the options if we want to actually go back to earlier versions? So this is the part I want to actually hand over to George, so he can tell us a bit more.
So we haven't forgotten about all of you who are still using SQL 2008, 2008 R2. And for those of you who want encryption, for SQL 2012. So what we've done is we have released a tool called, creatively, Microsoft Backup to Windows Azure tool. So what is it? What is this tool? This tool is a standalone installation that adds backup to Windows Azure capabilities, encryption, and compression to prior versions of SQL Server. So it doesn't matter if you're using SQL 2005, 2008, or 2008 R2, or 2012. You can use this tool to back up to the cloud almost from any version, as long as you have a Windows Azure storage account. So also, this tool adds backup encryption to these versions as well. So this tool can encrypt and compress your backups as you need it and if you want it. And this tool is easy, very easy to configure. You can install it in 5 minutes, and you can configure it in another 5 minutes. Mm. Last but not least, for those of you who do not have a Windows Azure account or for some reason do not want to use the cloud storage, you can use this tool to encrypt and compress your backup locally. Mm. So you can use it to, you know, add that feature to your SQL Server instances as well.
Yep, I think, you know, a lot of times we heard, you know, our customers asking for backup encryption for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. So this would be their route to actually now get it all supported for even earlier versions, which is really cool.
Definitely. So let me show you actually how it works. Here I have a, well, Windows Azure VM instance. You can use this on your on-premise as well. And I have a single database over here. So the tool is actually, the configuration is actually this window over here. So you can see we have rules that dictate what the tool actually looks for in a file system. For example, this one here looks for files, with the .bak extension in the F local backups path. So it looks, so whenever SQL Server backs up to this path, the tool will then will look for the IO operations actually into the this file by SQL Server. Now, in this step, we can choose to use local storage, in which case these fields won't apply, or we can choose to use Windows Azure storage, which in which case you will have to provide the storage account, access key, and container. So let's use local storage. And now in here, you can see you can provide encryption. We're using AES-256, provide a password of your own, and you can enable compression or disable compression as you want. So let's finish. So under the local backup, I have already created a backup, and you can see you have two files here. One is the actual backup, the backup stub file that we have. The other one is the encrypted backup file. So let's do an Azure backup. So here I have a rule that dictates that I have to, that the tool will stream the backup to the cloud, and I have provided my account key. Now let's do a backup. Task, backup. As you can see, the interface here doesn't change at all. SQL Server is not aware of what's going on in the background by done by this service. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to choose a backup location that is the Azure backup folder and provide a file name. And now click OK. So the backup is done. And let's go to the folder. Remember, we are seeing two backup files over here. But let's see. We only see one here. This is the stub file that we have. And let's go to the container. And now you can see the backup files over here on my storage account.
Cool.
Restoring a database works relatively the same way. So let's choose the backup file that we done. Backup. So let's restore it to something else. And click OK. And you see the restoration is finished as normal. So you can use this because it does, because SQL Server isn't aware of you know what's going on in the background by the service, you can use it with any instance that you have 2008, 2008 R2, and 2014 even. So let's go back. So this is pretty cool. We haven't forgotten about, you know, we haven't forgotten about our loyal users from, you know, before who uses, you know, our older instances. So we have also added a really, really cool feature in SQL 14, which is managed backup. Mm-hmm. So Xin, can you talk a little about that?
Sure. So managed backup is really to take a step further compared to the backup to cloud feature that we have just introduced. So the backup to cloud feature, like, you know, whether you are doing that through the UI, you're doing that through T-SQL, SMO, or even the tool, a lot of times you're thinking this still as a manual option. Even for maintenance plan, for example, when you're thinking about it, you actually just, you know, deciding on whether, you know, how frequent that is going to be done, but the underlying backups doesn't really have that much intelligence. So that's the whole reason that we're introducing this new feature called managed backup. We're actually taking care of your backups, not just the backup itself, but also the policy of managing those backups. So the origination of this idea is that, you know, we want to provide, especially for customers who are already using the Windows Azure virtual machines, running their SQL servers in those virtual machines, to actually take a full advantage of this storage, so that they think of this, you know, they inherit all the benefits that the storage provides, like the bottomless storage, and also you don't have to manage all the devices. You have zero hardware management requirements. And also, on top of that, our algorithm provides a lot of intelligence, which we'll talk a little bit more later. And what you want to think about this, that, you know, this is a feature that involves very little exposure of the knobs for you to really kind of meddle in around, because the idea is really to free up your mind, to actually leave you to focus on something more important, like your app development. So this is why we have our ideal candidates is really like, you know, small, medium business, you know, who actually the customers may not be that seasoned with DBA type of, you know, jobs, and they want to actually this to be taken care of. What they want to focus on is to get a guarantee of their recoverability, which is exactly what we're providing in here.
Okay, sweet. So, mm-hmm. I mean, backup, database backups are usually, you know, my last line of defense against, you know, data corruption,
absolutely,
data loss, you
yes.
know, failures. I mean, usually I would want to be involved in this process as much as possible, you mm-hmm. know. So, why do I want to hand it off to, you know, to the computer to do it for me instead of, mm-hmm. you know?
That's a fair question, because a lot of customers, you know, we know that this may not be for everybody. So that is why we want to make sure when we're thinking about it, it is the guarantee of the recoverability that we're providing, as well as, you know, you can take full advantage of the cost of the storage, you know, lowering mm-hmm. your cost, and also depending on, you know, your comfort level, you know, whether you want this to be taken care of. This is a trade-off between your, you know, you want to focus on your business logic, and also you want to free up your cycles to make sure, you know, especially for some of the archiving options, we see this as a great right. opportunity. So this is why, you know, when we're really summing it up, it comes down to two aspects. One is that, you know, you can actually do a bit larger scale management now. Mm-hmm. Thinking of this feature, you can not only take it advantage on the database level, per mm-hmm. database, but also you can actually do it on the entire SQL instances. So for instance, if you have thousands of SQL, you know, databases on right. a SQL server instance, this would be really ideal, so that you have this kind of, you know, out-of-the-box default value turned on, applied to all these databases, and then you don't have to worry about a thing. And then all of these are going to be uploaded to Windows Azure Storage account and maintained, or, you know, retain those for a period of time that you specify. And that is going to be actually adding a lot more value as we see it. So that's probably going to be jumping right into the, you know, business, you know, how we actually think about the intelligence. So the intelligence, you know, there are actually quite a few aspects of it. But I want to just, you know, highlight two aspects in here. One is what we call as a main loop. This is like, you know, the brain of this algorithm, to think about, you know, how we actually deciding on whether or how frequent we want to take a backup. So whether it comes down to a full backup or a log backup, we have certain thresholds that we consider. So it's not just DOM-ly, like, you know, a maintenance plan that takes a backup at certain interval, but it also considers the activity of your system that is live. So it actually see, you know, whether it needs to fall back or it actually needs to be more aggressive. For instance, you know, if we're thinking about the full backup on a regular database, you know, we actually take about a full backup every week as a bare minimum. And also log backup, it takes, you know, the loop actually runs every 15 minutes. We loop and go through each and individual database to see whether there is a need to take a full a log backup in that case. Based on what? Based on the log accumulation to see whether there has been enough change. For instance, if there has never been a change applied to this database for the last, you know, 15 minutes, why take a backup? You know, there is no reason that, you know, you don't have data loss in that particular case, right? So we don't have to actually just do that, you know, kind of on the drum. And that's why, you know, this offers a lot of, you know, opportunity actually to optimize. And on the other hand, we also want to highlight, you know, there is the retention. Retention actually is not just, you know, based on the timestamp that we keep your file up to the Windows Azure Storage account for that duration, but more, we actually look at the dependencies between your backup files and determine which files need to be kept just so that we can guarantee your recoverability up to that days. So for instance, if you have a 14 days of retention, even if you drop your database on that spot, we'll still keep those files just so to make sure that you are able to recover. So this is going to be, you know, a lot more intricate than those actually we see, you know, based on timestamps. So this is something, you know, we want to also, you know, highlight as well.
Excellent. This looks really, really cool. But I just want to, you know, I'm a visual learner. I want to see it in action. So can you show us
how
it works?
Yeah, that brings us to our demo. So I have a virtual machine in here, which is already in Windows Azure, but it doesn't have to be. So it can be any machine that you have probably on-premise. So for instance, in here, if you remember, we actually have in the menu backup option, we need to have a container, right? But for Windows, for our, you know, managed backup, we actually take care of even the creation of the containers and also, of course, the file naming of your backup files. So for instance, in here I have this SQL Server instance, and based on that, I already have a container created. So you can see that in here, wow, I already have a number of backups already taken. Why? This is because I actually just, you know, previously set up the feature. So if you remember, for the backup to cloud option, we need a credential. And similarly in here, this is also a prerequisite for you to be able to have a credential so that you can communicate. You have a way to actually upload your backup files to the Windows Azure Storage account. Once you have done that prep step, you can just, you know, use this main SQL statements. This is the stored procedure you would want to use to enable the managed backup, or what we call it, you know, smart backup, because we think it's pretty intelligent. And in here I have, for example, in here I have this at the instance level, meaning that all the new databases that I'm going to be creating at this point and on, I would actually use this. This would be actually applied to all of these databases. So they come out of the box, have already this, you know, being covered. You also may notice that, you know, I have encryption in here as well. And this is also based on the certificate that you would need to create beforehand. Of course, this is an option, so you don't have to use that. And of course, in addition to the instance level, you also have the option to actually see, I can actually enable this on the database level, or you can override that, the database, you know, the instance default by this particular value. So for instance, I can actually do different, you know, either a different storage account, or actually I can even do a different retention period, whichever you would like. So this has already been applied. And secretly, I've also actually have a little bit seasoning going on, actually, because we want to see things in action, right? And
right.
I just mentioned that we actually have this, the algorithm takes care of the backups every 15 minutes.
Uh-huh.
This is the loop through that it's done. But, you know, right now I want to show things in action, so we don't want people to sit and wait and see how those backups are going to be popping up. So that's why I actually reduce the frequency, so they're actually going to be much more aggressive. So it's going to be actually looking through all the backups or the databases actually every 15 seconds. This is, of course, it's not going to be the case, you know, when you are seeing in production. This is just something I internally set up because of the demo purposes.
Okay.
So let's see why that is going to be important. So before that, let's first check off to see if we actually see the results in here. Yeah, we can confirm now that the managed backup is actually enabled, and also the retention is set to be 30 days. This is at instance-wide, and the storage URL it goes to is just, you know, corresponding to my storage account I just mentioned, so which is exactly the same in here. And now I'm actually going to be doing something a little bit more interesting. What I want to do is that, as we can see in here, we have a number of databases. We have WPC and TestDB, a number of them. But, you know, they have been sitting in here for a little while, and with the fixed number of database backups, you know, there is no more activity that's being generated. They're just sitting down there. But for this particular database called Fabricam Managed, I want to actually trigger some activity so that we can see whether this is going to make some difference and how the managed backup is going to handle that. So what I'm doing right now is to actually generate a fake load. So it keeps running, and we can then compare and see the differences in terms of the backups that's going to be showing up in this container.
All right.
So let's give it a couple, maybe 30 seconds or more for it to finish, and then we can actually refresh this container and see if the number of backups showing up in here would be any different. And of course, for the rest of the databases, it's not going to be impacting, so we don't expect those to actually to change.
Okay, so...
Okay, looks like it just have finished. And then if you remember, we have just seen, I think, you know, a new log backup to pop up. So this is, you know, why we claim this is the, you know, intelligence of the algorithm, not just only to actually manage the instance, the creation of the containers, the retention, but also it takes into the activity of your databases to actually, you know, even do throttling if there are a lot more activity going on. So even user action detection. For instance, if your customer do actually delete some of the files, we also try to mitigate that by taking a more immediate, you know, full backup in that case, so that you don't actually have, extended exposure over time, you know, on your recoverability.
Cool.
So that's that.
So it looks pretty smart to me. So my understanding is that this is a new feature in SQL 2014. I mean, this is a V1 product, and usually with V1 we have, you know, limitations.
Absolutely.
And, you know,
yep.
Kind of, you know.
You're spot on.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Actually, this is the list of our limitations for V1. We actually think, you know, of course, you know, there is a boundary for us to, you know, do the scoping. Mm-hmm. So that's why, you know, a couple of things here I want to mention. First of all, the destination for all your backups for managed backup is only right now supporting the Windows Azure storage. So we cannot, for now, for instance, do Amazon or any other, you know, kind of storage, cloud storage type. And also the backup types. As you can see, the difference between the menu option is that the menu route allows you to do differential backup. But, you know, for managed backup for now, we can only do full backup and also T-log backups. This is also a scoping, you know, decision. We have to, you know, mm-hmm. cut somewhere. And also the databases, you know, we only do support, you know, user databases. So for system databases, it's not supported for now. For recovery mode, it's right now only support either you do full or bulk load mode, and we don't support, you know, like simple recovery mode. And, you know, something like, you know, you would actually expect is that it is, in, you know, inherently it would actually be in conflict with some of the other, you know, backups in parallel. If you're setting them up side by side, it is very easy to actually to confuse the algorithm, because the we will actually recognize that as, you know, a broken chain, because, you know, the LSN will no longer be consecutive if it's taken also in parallel by another manual backup or maintenance plan. And then in that case, we would actually be triggering more backups to compensate. So that is the case where we see conflict. You know, that's why, you know, you would only want to enable one at the, you know, at one time. So those are some of the, you know, V1 limitations that we'll be considering and also addressing, and some of them currently are really just by design.
Okay. All right. So that means that I can't actually, I wouldn't want to take a manual backup if I enabled managed backup.
You would want to, if you, the option is still there. You can actually do a copy-only backup, for example, if you want to do the manual route. And then, you know, in that case, it wouldn't impact the backup chain recognized by the managed backup. In that case, you know, we're still intact, and then we can continue, guaranteeing your recoverability.
All right, sweet. Okay, so today we've talked about, in summary, today we talked about how we can backup to URL, how we can use T-SQL, use PowerShell, use SMOL, and we can use UI to backup to a Windows Azure account. We talked about the backup to Azure tool that applies to both the current version, SQL 14, SQL 12, and the previous version, SQL 2008 and SQL 2008 R2. And today we talked about the managed backup to Windows Azure, which is a really, really cool feature that can help you maintain your databases and, you know, take the load off of you and, you know, just gives you the cycles to actually do things that, you know, help your business more than, you know, ensuring that the backup is there. So we're going to take a 15-minute break. Don't go away. We'll be right back.